Africa. I don't see anyone.
Okay, let me go back to the shop.
Okay, we got two people now. So it must be working. Just looking at the video.
Is that it?
Well, it should show that we're live.
Wow, that's going to vary on the mandolin, all right?
There it is.
There it is.
Very good. Yeah, let's see if the sounds are good. Okay, it's good.
Yep.
If you don't love your neighbor, if you gossip about him, if you never have mercy, if he gets into trouble and you don't try to help him, then you don't love your neighbor and you don't love
what'd she do?
I see you type
E off. That's funny. Is Brian Parrott on there?
Oh, yeah.
Another song? There's a God Almighty, and you got to love it. If you want salvation, then home on high. If you say you love it, while you hate your neighbor, then you know.
Surgery schedule.
Oh, really?
That's good.
Okay.
Next week.
That's good enough.
Jamie's here. The one that Ryan's
Yeah. Okay.
Cool.
He said she was going to invite her.
Aaron McDaniel's on the three-finger style guitar.
Can we go up there? All right. I don't know if you can hear me or not.
Welcome to Life Issues. That was a good little introduction there. Brian Parrott sent that to us, and I hope you enjoyed the little bluegrass music. And thank you for tuning in tonight. This is our sixth weekly virtual Life Issues recovery meeting. So thank you for joining us. And I've got just a couple of announcements before Brother Pat speaks about recovery. You can go to our YouTube channel. I think Jim's going to put up my contact information behind for Pat and I both. Feel free to contact us if we can help you in any way. and look up our YouTube. We post these on YouTube the following day. So feel free to look that up and send it to somebody if you think it'll help them. While we're talking and tonight, feel free to acknowledge that you're here just by texting that you're watching, or if you have a prayer request, we'd be glad to work that in at the end. And I want to give you a little bit of coronavirus update. It looks like there's over 3 million cases worldwide, and there's over 215,000 deaths now. And in our own country, there's over 1 million cases now, with around 58,000 deaths. So continue to be careful. Pray for our country. Pray for our first line responders and healthcare folks. Hopefully you've got your stimulus package by now. Some of us still haven't, but sounds like the check's in the mail, so hopefully it is. Wanted to give you just a little bit of update from our own governor, Mr. Parsons, and our own plans for reopening to meetings. Wanted to just read here from official government document. It says Missouri's initial recovery phase begins May 4th. So May 3rd is Sunday, so May 4th is next Monday. During this phase, we can gradually start to reopen economic and social activity. This will be a deliberate process and is flexible to adapt to the situation. Some communities may be able to reopen at a faster rate, while others may need to continue restrictions to keep the virus from spreading. During this time, we should limit our activity and interactions and continue to maintain social distancing and practice good hygiene to protect our neighbors and ourselves. And in our own church building here, we've disinfected several rooms, and the church is ready for visitors soon. And wanted you to know, with our own meetings, we're taking this serious. I know personally, just I'm almost 60 years old, so to some degree, I suppose I'm at risk. But anyway, I couldn't sleep well if I knew I had infected someone or caused someone harm in any way. So we are going to sanitize our facility before and after events that we have. We're going to wipe down surfaces and handles and restrooms. And don't be offended, but we may take your temperature at the door as you come in, just to make sure you don't have a fever or cough. There's going to be masks available at least the first week. After that, we may ask you to bring your own. And so if social distancing is not possible or you just want to protect yourself, those will be available. And so as far as when we're going to start meeting again, I think our church is going to start meeting the 10th, I believe, but there'll be some more information about that. But as the pastor of Life Issues, I wanted you to hear from me directly. We're going to start meeting Friday the 8th, the 8th of May, at 7 o'clock. That's our normal meeting time. Normal meeting day is Friday the 8th. So next Tuesday, I hope to be able to give you a few more details. I missed a pastor's meeting because of just getting here tonight. So the pastors discussed some things tonight about our church meeting. But I can tell you that we're going to try to meet Friday, May 8th. And so if you can plan to be here, do not bring any food. We're going to have just individually wrapped snacks and individual drinks, sodas and water. We've ordered some gloves, and we'll have some more masks available. We've got one volunteer already to help disinfect things before and after. So anyway, we'll be prepared for May 8th, and I'll give you a few more details next Tuesday night. I don't know if there's any more prayer requests, but I know we're going to pray for Rich Hayes, for Tom Merritt, Rebecca Wilbur, and her son, Tayton. We want to lift up Brian Parrott's niece, Jamie. I think she has connected tonight, so give you a wave, Jamie. We've been praying for you and your liver issue and feel free to text in there and report any updates that you would like. And I just, one thing, you know, Jim Stovall just had his, is it 37 year anniversary or your first date or something, and it was prom, and he went to the prom with his first date with his wife now. And so proms are canceled, graduations are canceled, and so there's many things that are canceled and a lot of disappointments. But we're here, God's here, and he's still on his throne, and his word is true, and he loves you. Jesus Christ died for you. And so we're going to go to prayer here. My friend that was going to give his testimony tonight, he actually manages a kind of a sober living house. And I guess they got two new people from a penitentiary, and he actually could not be here tonight because of his commitment at his sober living house. So hopefully we'll get him back with us at another date. But I wanted to let you know we're going to have Pat continue with his study of the journey home. And but let's go to the Lord in prayer right now, and then I'm going to give the mic to Pat. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we enter your gates with thanksgiving. Father, I thank you for just the mood that was set there with the bluegrass music, loving you, and just kind of an upbeat music. And so, Father, I pray that everyone listening to the sound of my voice have a measure of joy in their heart, a measure of hope. I know Pat's talking about hope tonight, and we all need hope. And Father, I want to lift up, I want to intercede on behalf of my brother Rich Hayes, and he's burdened for his family that's a first responder there with coronavirus patients. For Tom Merritt with his job, his relative, his aunt that has cancer, I pray for Tom's finances. You'll bless him more abundant than he could even think. I pray for Rebecca and Tayton. Hopefully they're able to dial in tonight, and hopefully they just sense your love tonight, Father, as we open the Word of God. And Father, we do want to pray for Brian's niece, Jamie, with her liver situation. I do pray for the doctors and nurses to be able to minister the right treatment, the right drugs. Pray your good hand be upon her, Father. Give her direction and hope and just a path forward that her body will be made whole. And be with my brother Pat now. There's just a lot of fear and anxiety and unknowns. And so, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will just speak through Pat directly to hearts tonight. And, Lord, that people can break this cycle of addiction and find hope in you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Here's Pat.
All right. Thank you, Steve. Thank you. Okay, tonight we're going to be in chapter 2 of the Journey Home, and we're going to be talking about the path of progress will lead us continually toward hope. And I'm excited about tonight because as we're going through this process of the Journey Home, which is our pathway to breaking the cycle of addiction and experiencing salvation through Jesus Christ, I want to talk about that because hope is one of the most important things that we need to find right from the beginning. Chapter 1 was about brokenness, and we're going to leapfrog or piggyback, if you will, off of key principles that we find in every chapter. Tonight, we're going to look at some of those principles in increasing dynamic, if you will, from what we learned last week. And I don't know if you remember or not, but the key principle that we looked at last week was practicing the ABCs of faith. And I don't know if you remember, but that was to A, accept, B, believe, and 3, confess. And what I mean by that is we need to accept the nature of our addiction and where we are. Hey, we are all sinners, right? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So we're all in the same boat, so to speak. We need to accept that and begin to deal with our brokenness in order to see that the only solution is found in Jesus Christ. So we need to believe in Him. What does that mean? We need to put our trust in Him. And if we truly believe in Him, we need to practice that every day by faith. We need to go to Him in His Word, and we need to pray to Him and ask Him for help. And He answers that. That's where it brings us to the letter C, confess. We need to confess and cry out to Him. And we need that for salvation. The Bible says in Romans 10:9-10, that if we confess in our heart the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that He will save us. We need to confess continually, whether it's at the beginning of our journey in salvation or whether it is practicing it daily. We practice it continually, day after day, the ABCs of faith, as we go down the road in our journey of salvation and eternal life. So, tonight we're going to be discussing the journey of hopelessness in addiction must follow the path of faith to ignite the spark of hope. How do we do that? Through trust in God, through trust in Jesus Christ. So, as we talked about last week, they say that those that don't learn from history are destined to repeat it. And as I stated in chapter one, I guess that I know that this statement was, or at least it should have been, the anthem of my life. Moreover, I've heard the quote that time can be the cruelest of mockers. And I know that this was true from all of my experiences in addiction. The shame that I felt, I talked about last week, in addiction, we mock ourselves. Can you relate to that? If God had not intervened, like I said last week, in order to help me break the cycle of addiction, then I would have been destined to repeat my same addictive behavior until it killed me. Like a repeating nightmare, it would happen again and again and again, and got increasingly worse every time. I not only learned to play with fire, but I got burned many times. I got burned with divorce. I got burned with loss of jobs, wages, cars, houses. It also caused the loss of any purposeful relationship with anybody that I had. And it caused a definite separation between me and God. So this also led to many uncontrollable circumstances and consequences. There was always a natural downward progression that ended in the loss of everything that I loved. So I had remembered that in the Old Testament, it pictures these cycles of sin and that led to addiction, and that they foretold of this curse of not heeding the warning that God gives us in these pictures. I remembered how that it said this in Romans 15:4, where it says, "For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we, through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope." Tonight, that's what I want to talk about. We need hope. We need it desperately. If we're going to recover, if we're going to follow God, we need to know where our hope rests, and we need to know how to follow it. So let's pray, and I'll begin. Father, I thank You so much for everything that You're doing in Life Issues and in this church. I thank You that You sent Your Son to die on the cross for me. I thank You that You never gave up, that You continue to continually seek me and to love me and to show me Your mercy so that You could show me Your grace. And I just ask for anyone that's out there tonight that might be struggling, that might still be in their brokenness or feel hopeless, I pray that You would show something to them, that You would speak to them through Your words so that they might have hope. And we'll give you all the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. So, hope is what everybody needs, right? I know I need it. Don't we all need hope for tomorrow in order to get us through the uncertainties of today? Hope is what gets us through the valleys of shame and the hills and the heights of excitement, the valleys of depression, just like this song that we heard. We all have to face these in our life, these hills and these valleys that we go through. Sometimes in addiction, it's an emotional roller coaster of hills and valleys. And the thing is, we need to get off. And the only way that we can get off that emotional roller coaster is through faith in God and the hope of the promises that He gives to each and every one of us. Hope, hope pushes us beyond our natural born limits. Hope is what forces us to expose the lies that we have believed about ourselves in order to protect our hidden agenda to get high or to feel normal again, right? Has anybody ever felt that before? The reason why we do what we do in addiction? Hope leads us out of the confusion that the cycle of addiction of sin creates. Hope demands of us the courage that it takes in order for us to change for our own ultimate good. Because that's what God desires for us. It's our own ultimate good. In our addiction, that all gets clouded and it's so confusing. So, our key pivotal point tonight is that courage is what fans the flames of the promise of hope. Courage. I want to talk about this because if we are ever going to truly recover, we need to learn to cultivate courage. The courage that it takes to overcome the obstacles that we face. We do this by trusting in the light of every promise that God gives us in His Word. We must understand that courage is not the absence of fear, but actually the ability to face your fear through faith in Jesus Christ and overcome it. I want to give you a definition of courage that I heard. I think this was FDR when he gave his inaugural address back many, many years ago. But he said, courage is not the absence of fear, but the ability to persevere in the face of it and triumph over it. The brave is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear. And I go on to say that recovery requires it. We have to learn to exercise courage. That's what gives us hope. This verse in Romans 15:4 is the positive benefits of hope infused into our veins. As it starts out again, Romans 15:4. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning. That means for your learning and mine too, right? This is not just written for some fictional character. God is talking and trying to show something directly to us. He's making it very personal. And that's the way we need to take it too. Remember back in chapter 1 when God spoke to me when I was broken? And He said to me, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. God made it very personal to me that night. And I hope He makes it very personal to you. He wants to. I know that. So, I remembered how the nation of Israel struggled in their sin. And I went back and looked at those things in the Old Testament because it says whatsoever things that were written aforetime, right? It's speaking about aforetime before Christ, right? The Old Testament. And He also wrote this in reference to us personally. In order to show you a time in your life before you made a decision to turn your trust over to the care of Jesus Christ and the power of recovery and salvation. He did this by writing to us in physical types and pictures, in graphic detail. He did so in order to show us examples of how to and how not to think and to act and to feel. I remember how the nation of Israel had struggled with sin by going against what God had specifically told them to do and what He told them not to do more specifically. I also remember that every time in my life when I went against God and what He told me to do in His Word, I would struggle with my understanding and my direction in life would get way off course. It then became increasingly impossible for me to navigate my way, and as a result of my confusion, I would depend more and more on my drug of choice to find comfort. I would depend more and more on my addiction. That only led to many, many more negative consequences. Can you relate to that? This in turn would lead me to suffer greater pain and eventually even greater consequences. Now, of course, the children of Israel, they didn't listen either. And they did the very things that made them feel instantly better through their tough situation. You know what I'm talking about? Instant gratification. And we've all been there in our addiction. They were coming out of slavery and bondage in Egypt, and only to wander in the desert wilderness with hunger and thirst and desire to go back to the only way that they knew in order to survive. Isn't that what we're like in our addiction? That survival instinct, we keep going back to it again and again and again just to cope with our sea of consequences and uncertainty. So they remained in bondage to the idea of doing what you have to do just to feel better for the moment. Sound familiar? I would continually seek comfort in my addiction for any major uncertainty, for any tough situation, for any time the internal floodwaters of fear would begin to rise in my good old reliable pain pills. The crazy thing was that the emotional pain that it caused was really 10 times worse. It was many times worse. And the physical pain than the physical pain that it got rid of. What an unbearable psychological torture chamber I subjected myself to. I did this all in a miserable attempt to feel better about myself in this hopeless situation. Why couldn't I admit the fact that I was wrong? I definitely knew that, and I was in desperate need of help. Well, they say that hindsight is 20/20, but really what I needed was the foresight to see around some of these things. And what I want to talk to you about tonight is how God gives us the foresight in His Word to navigate around some of these unforeseeable circumstances. So with all of my questions in mind, like why couldn't I see it? What's the real cause of this problem of my addiction? And I'm sure you've asked many, many of the same questions. With all these questions in mind, God slowly began to answer me. I found the answers to my questions in the pages of His Word. In my journey towards gaining hope and understanding, God began to reveal His purpose to me personally. And step by step, day by day, He began to reveal those things to me along the way. That's why we call this the journey home. In my personal journey of truth and my quest for hope, I set off in the direction of the Old Testament and I landed in the book of Exodus. And I looked at the children of Israel, and basically what it talks about in Psalm 107, I think I briefly touched on last week, where it talks about the cycle of sin that the children of Israel, when they came out of Egypt, and they would continually, they would go towards God and go towards the promised land, only to remember the things in Egypt, the things in their bondage or their addiction, and begin to remember it in a good way, when it wasn't necessarily good, it was really bad. But they thought, oh, we could go back to this, we could go back to that. And they start heading back to Egypt. And then they would start experiencing all the tough symptoms of their sin and the consequences, and they would turn around and they would go back. They did this four different times in Psalms 107. That's the first exercise in chapter 1. And it's a perfect picture of how we are in our addiction. In our, actually, that's what it's called. The wilderness that they were in was called the wilderness of sin. And that's where we find ourselves in addiction. In this desert wilderness with no way, no hope, no way of escape, and we're stuck. And we go for God a little while, and then we turn around and we go back for our pleasure or our immediate comfort. And then we find all the consequences and the struggles and the suffering that it creates, and we go back for God. We need to break that cycle. That's what the journey home is about. That's what Life Issue is about. More importantly, that's what faith in Jesus Christ is about. So, yeah, yeah. So, Exodus 20, verse 3, is what God gave them, the Ten Commandments, as they came out and they were in Mount Sinai, as they were going back and forth in the wilderness of sin. God gave them Ten Commandments. And really, it's the first commandment that I want to read to you that is the main commandment that you and I, the principle behind it, that you and I really need to grab hold of. Because in Exodus 20, verse 3, it says, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." Small g. No other gods, right? And we say, oh, I have no other gods, right? And we lie to ourselves, and we don't realize what God's talking about here. Other gods, small g, has to do with idols. And I know you're here tonight, you're thinking, idols? I've never served any other idol. Well, I want to talk about the key principle direction tonight, and that key principle direction in heading towards God and learning to break the cycle of our addiction is found through learning to apply trust in God's Word to break the cycle of addiction. You see, it's God's Word that actually changes us. It quickens us. And it's our faith that's tied to God's Word that begins to break that cycle and send us in the direction that God is trying to bring us towards His promised land. Because He's got many, many promises for you and I. But first, we need to learn to get into His Word and apply trust in it so that He can break the cycle of addiction, right? The curse of addiction. So now, before you say, I've never served any other gods, let me explain that in the Bible, the idea of serving gods, little g, was introduced as anything you put before the one true God. I think of what Jesus said to the disciples back in Matthew 6:33, where He said, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." That's really what recovery is all about, is seeking God first, putting Him first, putting Him at the top priority every single day. One of the things that I like to do, and I know Jim and Steve do the same, and many other people that go to this church, we found that if you want to keep from suffering from your addiction, or you want to keep from suffering the consequences of your sin, one of the absolute necessities is to get in God's Word every single morning. The first thing when you get up. I know in my addiction, the first thing I would grab for was that bottle of pain pills, and it would be the first thing. But now I grab for my Bible. That's the first thing I do, because that gives me the hope that I need to go down the path of recovery. And I hope you find that too. So we have to have God's Word in order to break this cycle of addiction. Back in Exodus, it says that as they headed towards the Promised Land, God gave them this commandment. He gave it to the children of Israel on their journey towards the Promised Land to protect them from what is known in recovery as stinking thinking. Have you ever had any stinking thinking? Well, that's what they were going through. You know, I'm going to go this way. And then, no, that was better when I went back. Well, I'm going to do this. And they kept changing. God wants to set us on a course where He changes our thinking. Remember what He said? I know the thoughts that I think toward you. God wants to give us His thoughts of peace and not of evil. He wants to change our stinking thinking. And God knew their own nature and their way of thinking that would cause them to stumble at His commands or His rules to live by, but He gave it to them anyway. And why is that, I wondered? It is so that we can get back up when we fall, right? We're all sinners. We all have this addictive nature to do what feels good, to find pleasure, to stoke the fires of our desire. And God gave us His Word so He could keep us on track so that we could truly find contentment and peace and not evil, right? So Adam and Eve, they were the first human beings that God ever created, and yet they bought into the devil's lies. He planted doubt, mistrust, and fear for God in their minds, right? All as a result of disobedience to the first law that God ever gave them, right? Don't eat of the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, right? They couldn't keep it, right? And the reason that God gave them His law was to protect them from all the harm, misery, and finally death that the disease of sin inflicted. It was passed on to their children, and Cain was angry at God because he didn't get the acceptance that he thought that he had earned from God. His brother Abel found the acceptance that Cain desired and thought that he deserved it more. So he killed him in a jealous rage in Genesis 4, 1 through 8, right? That's what sin does. It creates jealousy. It creates pride. It creates a sense of power and control. And it progressed all the way down through the whole human race, right? Noah got drunk at a crucial time when God needed him to lead his family. But God used him regardless, didn't He? And He can use you. God got a hold of him and He helped him make the human race continue after the flood, right? Aaron and Moses had these issues of power and control or trusting in themselves, right? That's why we call this life issues, because we all have these issues of power and control. And we all need that cycle of addiction broken in our lives, right? So that God can gain control of our heart and once and for all get control of their, once He got control of our hearts, He took control of their lives and He changed their destiny forever, right? So in every case, they had to reach the end of their rope. They had to reach their rock bottom or their brokenness, as we looked at last week. And I found my rock bottom certainly in county jail, and I wanted desperately and needed a change that would last this time forever. That's what God promises us, right? We have to look to those promises. I found that nothing made sense in my own way of thinking. Up was down, black was white, day was night. As I decided that I must go back to the basics and see what I had missed in God's Word, right, in His promises, I saw that God was saying to the children of Israel, now listen to me, because I'm about to show you a picture of your promised land. But before I do, I need you to understand the laws that I will give to you to help you stay settled in your promised land, right? Just like He gives to us. He gives us many, many promises that pertain to our promised land. That's that relationship with Jesus Christ, our deliverer, our Savior, our Lord, right? So I've already given them to you. So what I would like to do is give you the key that will help you understand. And it comes from Deuteronomy 4:29. And it says, but if thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find Him. If thou seek Him with all thy heart and with all thy soul. It's a powerful verse. Doesn't that sound like the theme of tonight? If we want to find hope, we need to learn to seek God with all our heart and all our soul. We need to seek Him daily. If we want hope, that's what we've got to seek. So I want to say it's a faith, recovery is a journey of faith where we navigate much like a ship on a sea of uncertainty, and God blows the inspiration into our sails. As faith is the boat that gets us across this ocean, God breathes, and actually that's what inspiration means. It means God breathed. He breathes the wind of faith into our sails so that we can navigate, that's what this rudder is, so that He can navigate us in His Word towards hope in His promises, right? Because God gives us the Holy Spirit of promise to inspire us, to direct us, to lead us, much like this ship, to take us to the other side of that large sea of uncertainty in our time of need, in our time of recovery. So, as I close here tonight, I want to give you a verse in the New Testament that sums it all up, what recovery is all about in finding that hope, where it says in Titus 2:13, it tells us, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. He's the great God. He is the number one. He's the only God. He needs to be our Savior and He needs to be our Lord if we're going to put Him first and navigate through the uncertainty of addiction in recovery and that addictive thinking and all the things that go along with it. We need to find hope in God's promises. So I'm going to turn it over to Steve, and he's going to close here in a minute. But I thank you for participating and being a part of this tonight. And I hope that all of you, I hope to see you soon as we join back together and we begin to break out and have groups again. So thank you for participating and hope to see you soon.
That was so good, Pat. That was rich. Amen. If you're at home, if you're sitting where you're sitting, just give Pat a hand. That was from the heart. And our Journey Home program really is solid. It weaves in and out of Pat's testimony. And so if you come to our meeting or if you get a hold of me, we can get you an application and we can assign a sponsor to you. And you can go through this program one-on-one. There's 9 lessons. Tonight you heard lesson two about hope. Last week we talked about brokenness, or, you know, sick and tired and hitting bottom, and showing your journey out of that, your journey home. And tonight Pat wanted to demonstrate hope by looking at the Old Testament, how God dealt with the nation of Israel to give them hope through the Scriptures. And as I'm sitting here, it's a little over 9 years ago, we started meeting right here in this trailer. You can't see the room around us, but Pat and I and Jim are here. There's just three of us. But we had one of our students that was successful right at the start, and his name was Phil. And hopefully you can hear this, Phil, but I'll never forget that Phil would say, "Boy, if I could just learn to play the tape forward." And I knew what he meant by that, because if we could see the consequences of using or smoking or shooting up or drinking or whatever we do in our addiction, if we could see the consequences that, man, we're going to lose this job, we're going to lose this relationship, we're not going to get to see our kids, our electricity is going to be cut off, whatever. And we got just a two-minute video I want to show in conclusion. I've got like one, two Dottie's surgeries next week. Ray and Stacy lost a baby this last week. They had a miscarriage. And she went to the doctor today, and they're really kind of grieving right now. We want to pray for Ray and Stacy. Before I came into the room tonight, we got a letter from an inmate. And so I want to pray. It's a man that I've invested a lot of time in personally, and so he seems repentant. So we want to pray for him. Melissa said she's trying to start a job. We want to pray for Melissa. I know Brian and Angie are heavy-hearted for their son Connor to get him home. And Christina asked prayer for quit smoking. So we're going to play this video, and then I'll come back and pray at the end.
Satan knows our desires. Listen, guys. Satan knows our desires and offers to meet them in ways that seem innocuous and harmless. If we could see the results of sin before choosing it, we wouldn't choose it. We know that the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23, but it seems hard at the time to believe that this warning applies to us. There's a voice that encourages us to believe that no one will know or be hurt by what we're considering. That's where the fear of the Lord comes in, a cream puff instead of a rattlesnake. One reason sin flourishes is that it's treated like a cream puff instead of a rattlesnake. My wife, when she teaches, she always says, until you make drugs, alcohol, gambling, whatever it is, until you make it your enemy, you're not going to quit. As long as it's your friend, you're going to continue to do it. You have to make it your enemy. We know a cream puff's not good for us. One cream puff has about 25 grams of sugar in it, but we look at it and go, well, that can't really hurt, so we go ahead and eat it. But we wouldn't think about picking up a rattlesnake, because we know a rattlesnake bite could kill us. Here's the point. Satan will seldom tempt us to do something we know is as deadly as a rattlesnake's bite, but he will tempt us every day to choose sins that we think we can commit without consequence.
When Aaron joined the band, he never played the trumpet. That's
good. Yeah. So that is that was Bill Corum. He's been here to our meetings two or three times. He wrote the book, The Ultimate Pardon, and he's a friend of this ministry. And I just thought that was really good advice as we close tonight. That really and. Your sin and my sin is not my friend. It is my enemy. And the way we win this war is one battle at a time. The way you win a war is one battle at a time. And so your battle may be waking up tomorrow and, you know, saying no to sin, to saying no to whatever. And but I'm going to pray right now. And I know I had to get to that point in my own life where my sin was not my friend. It was leading me away from the Lord, away from my wife, away from the ministry that God put me in. And God had to do a work to bring me back. And that's what we're here. That's all we're all about here at Life Issues, is changing what we believe so we can change the way we think, so we can change the way we act. And so let's just go to the Lord in prayer now, and we'll close our time together. Father in heaven, I want to come to your gates with thanksgiving for my friend Pat, and just all the changes you've made in his life, and even the ones you're continuing to make, Lord. Just thank you for Pat being an instrument of your service, and just a tool in your hand, Father. I thank you for using him tonight, and for using Jim's gifts and abilities to help me and help others, and to propagate the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the world. And Father, you are so good. And Father, we just thank you in advance for getting Dottie's surgery scheduled for May 6th. We lift her up. We lift up the physicians that her, I think it's her hip surgery, will be successful. And Lord, she can have just a short recovery time and be back with us soon. And for Ray and Stacy, as they are grieving over the loss of a child, and just their burden to want children together, and to have another disappointment, Father, may they not lose faith in you. And Lord, for my friend in the jail that wrote to Jim tonight, that Father, continue to take away his addiction, Father, take away his abusive anger and just the things that took him there, Father. I pray you'll just do a work in him and bring him back to us. And Lord, for Melissa, she is going to have a job, and she's probably got to juggle the kids there. And just give her the energy, the wisdom, the strength to do a good job and to find contentment in that, and to, Lord, that she might be paid well for it. And Lord, for Brian and Angie's son, Connor, I haven't even met him, but Lord, they're just really homesick to see him. And I pray for any disciplinary things that he's dealing with, that Lord, you'll help him to mature and grow past anything he struggles with, and just be with the caseworkers and bring him back to their home soon, Father. And for Christina, as she is attempting to quit smoking, I pray, Lord, whether it's cold turkey or just weaning yourself off, Lord, I pray that she will be successful, and help her to know that you're there with her each step of the way. And so, Father, just as we conclude, I pray you'll give each of us hope. I just thank you for the good weather today, the thoughts of reopening our economy and our state and our country. Lord, may we have good peripheral vision just to see needs, to be able to help others around us. I pray, Lord, for this church and this ministry, that we will not, any of us, get the virus, that you'll help us to be able to condescend to those in low estate, that we might be able to help others. And Father, dismiss us now with your blessing. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. That's all for Life Issues. We'll see you next Tuesday.